And if you would, open your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. This morning, we're continuing the series we began last week entitled The Script. And of course, as we said last week, your life is a story and God is the screenwriter. God has created you as a complex character and written you into this world so you can play your part in a very unique story. We learned last week that indeed the story that we are in is really the story of Jesus. And we are supporting characters in that story. We are Robin to his Batman. But we are major players in his story. And so when God created us, he did so because he felt we were needed in this earth. He saw a role that we needed to fill, and he created us with the giftings and the abilities that we needed to fill that role. And there are many people today that God created to fill a role. God wrote a script for them to live out, that God have gotten off script. And so they're unhappy. They're disillusioned. They're depressed. They feel lost or insignificant. They are rudderless. They don't have any real purpose. And the purpose of this series is to help everyone to get on script, to go ahead and live out the story God had in mind when he created you. Because when you live out your story, you'll find your life will matter. You will make a mark for God. You'll find you'll enjoy your life. You'll find that God's ending for you, God's future for you is amazing. And so last week, we looked at four things that would help you to live your story. And the first was that you need to focus on your mission. And we actually went down that line a little bit more with the men on Wednesday. The second is to overcome the enemy, our antagonist, Satan. The third is to become like Jesus. And the fourth was to enjoy your victories. So today we're going to go a step farther with this. And what I want to talk about today is a topic that you absolutely need to grasp if you're going to live your story. We're about to get into some revelation that you have to have in you. But if you get this today, if you get a hold of it, it will revolutionize your life. If you get a hold of it, you will find that it is actually easy for you to live your story and be who God made you to be and have what God wants you to have. So let's start here in 1 John chapter 4 in verse 19 actually. Go ahead and read it with me. Ready? Read. We love him because he first loved us. Notice the Bible tells us that God, that's who the subject of the sentence is, first loved us. So when we were sinners, as the Bible says in Romans 5, God loved us. When our behavior offended him, he still loved us. When we were his enemies, maybe even hated him, the Bible says that as well, he loved us. And notice that the word loved here comes from a Greek word. We know New Testament is translated from the Greek. It comes from a Greek word, which is agape. And the word agape means affection and a love feast. When you think about a feast, you think about a lot of food. Well, God has a lot of love for you. So when the Bible says he loved us, it's saying that God had affection for us. God had affection for you. God also had a love feast for you. He had a lot of love for you. And because of his love to you, you now, if you're a believer, love him. But it started with you recognizing that he loves you. Go to Jeremiah chapter 31. Somebody say, Jesus loves me. Jeremiah chapter 31, and let's learn a little bit more about this love he has for you. Verse 3, and I'm gonna move a little bit today with these scriptures, so if you can't stay up with us, that's all right. We got them on the screens for you. It says, the Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Somebody say everlasting. So his love is like the Energizer Bunny. It just keeps going and going and going and going. God loves you, because this applies to every person on this planet, with an everlasting love, which means that his love for you is unconditional. It's not dependent on what you do or what you did. He just loves you. This love is selfless. It's not dependent on what you did to him or for him, whether or not you did some things that would bless him or not. He just loves you. The best text message you ever received would be from God. And it would just simply say, I will always love you. Because that's what this is telling us. He will always love you. He's loved you with an everlasting love. A number of years ago, Sister Kay shared a story about how she was on vacation and this guy was trying to pick her up, I guess. You know, he was wooing her. And he had some game. Because he said to her, he said, I have loved you my whole life. He said, before I met you, I loved the thought of you coming. That's some game right there. Am I right, ladies? I mean, that was pretty good. But I'm here to tell you that before you were conceived, the Bible says God knew you. We talked about that last week. And he loved you and loved the thought of you coming. Come on, go to 139th Psalm. God loves his characters that he's created, his God ideas. He loves us. He loves you. He loved you before he even wrote you down on the paper. Before he even put you into the world. Let's get even more understanding of how much God loves you. Somebody say, Jesus loves me.
Jesus loves me.
139th Psalm, verse 14. Notice what David said. He said, I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. If you state it out, it means I'm reverently. You took your time. I'm uniquely made. I'm one of a kind. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well, that my soul knoweth greatly. The next verse says, my substance or my body was not hid from thee when I was made in secret, and curiously wrought or intricately formed is what that means, in the lowest part of the earth. Your eyes did see my body, yet being imperfect, and in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. Notice how much God loved you. That God actually paid attention to every aspect of your development in your mother's womb. I shared last week about and my wife and I, we had we found out that she was pregnant with our first daughter, how, you know, we kept track of everything. I mean, I literally carried around in my wallet for years the first ultrasound. And I remember us sitting down and every once in a while, and she'd have her book, What to Expect When You're Expecting, and she'd be telling me what's happening with the baby right now. We did that because of how valuable Alexis was to us. And that's exactly how God treated you. In fact, the Bible reveals to us that as much as we as parents love our children, how much more does God love us? So much so that notice, in fact, go to Luke chapter 12. We're going to go back to Psalm 139 in a minute. But look at Luke chapter 12. This is Jesus speaking. Somebody say it again. Jesus loves me. Verse 6 says, are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 farthings? And not one of them is forgotten before God. Not 5 sparrows, it's just birds. And he says they're sold for 2 farthings, which are just coins. We might say pennies today. So at that time, you could get 5 sparrows for 2 pennies. And yet the Bible says not one of them is forgotten before God. Man may not value them that much, but God hasn't forgotten about one of them. The word forgotten here means to lose out of mind. It's translated elsewhere to neglect. So God has not neglected even one of them. He's paid attention to every single sparrow. In fact, if we were to go to Matthew and we find a very similar teaching, the Bible says not one of them falls to the ground without the master's notice, without the Father noticing it. So notice how valuable even a bird is to God. Notice the next scripture. But even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Now, he's not telling you how valuable birds are just so you can see that God values birds. He's making a point here. And his point is that he, as much as he values birds, he values you even more, so much so that even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Now, I don't know who it is you love. It may be your wife, it may be your kids, it may be your parents or your brothers or your sisters, but I can guarantee you have not taken the time to sit down and count every hair on their head. I mean, this is love right here. When God keeps track of the hair on your head, when a hair falls, he knows. So how about when you fall? He cares because he loves you. Notice the rest of his point here. Fear not, therefore, because you are of more value than many sparrows. You are more valuable than many sparrows. The Message translation says you're worth more than a million of them. Go back to 139 Psalms. Somebody said, Jesus loves me. And there's a song that many of us are raised on that grew up in church. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Yeah, Jesus loves you. I don't know what you've done or what you're going to do, but I can tell you one thing for sure about your life. Jesus will always love you. He loves you the way you are right now. He loves you the way you will be. He will always love you. Now, he may not always love everything you do, but he will always love you with a love that's beyond your comprehension. He values you. Look at 139th Psalm again. We've already read what he said about God paying attention to every aspect of your development. Verse 17 says this, how precious also are your thoughts to me or about me. So God thinks precious thoughts about you. He's not thinking about how disappointed he is with you. He's thinking precious thoughts about you. Now he may be disappointed with something you may or may have not done, but it doesn't change how he values you. It doesn't change how he feels about you. How precious are your thoughts about me, oh God? How great is the sum of them? It's not one or two. It's a great sum. If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee. So God is thinking precious thoughts about you all the time. Why would God do that? Because he loves you. Many of us remember the first time we thought we were in love. And ladies really can relate to this. But the guys can too, though. All you did was think about that little knucklehead. Come on, it's all you thought about, all you talked about. Some of your friends just wanted to get away from me because they was tired of hearing about. And eventually that wore off when you fell in love with somebody else. But God feels like that about you all the time. And it's never worn off no matter what you've done or what you haven't done. He just loves you. He's in love with you. He just is. And there's nothing you can do to change it. Nothing. There's always somebody who's on your side, who's rooting for you, who's cheering for you. It's God. Whew. I'm going to go to Ephesians chapter 1. Somebody says,
Jesus loves me.
God loves you personally as though you're the only person on the planet. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 18.
Many of us are familiar with this teaching here. This is the Ephesians prayer. And the Bible talks about the things God wants us to have a revelation of.
Ephesians 1 and verse 16 says, I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him. What does God want us to have revelation about, to understand in our hearts or with our hearts about? The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, number one, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, the benefits he's provided for you in Christ Jesus. Number two, what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Now that's a mouthful right there. But God wants you to receive revelation of it, understanding of what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. The key phrase here is his inheritance. A lot of times we read this, we quote the scripture, and we say your inheritance or my inheritance. That's not what it said. It said his inheritance. Well, what's his inheritance? Well, don't go there because for time's sake, but I'll read to you Deuteronomy 32:9, and this is just one of a number of scriptures that reveal this to you. In Deuteronomy 32, verse 9 says, for the Lord's portion is his people. Jacob is the lot of his inheritance. So the bottom line is, God's inheritance is God's people. Wealth to God isn't gold or silver or land. Wealth to God is you.
Amen.
You are his diamonds, ladies. And God is saying here that he wants us to know the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. In other words, when God looks at you, he sees you as so valuable that you have glory. You got so much glory that your glory has riches. Oh, you didn't hear what I just said. And you may look in the mirror and say, I don't see that. But that's what God sees. You want to talk about a glow? When God sees you, he sees a glow. He sees glory. And your glory has riches. You are valuable to God. And God wants you to get revelation of just how valuable you are to him. He wants you to see that so you can see that he loves you. And why he loves you like he does. Go to 1 John chapter 4. Jesus loves me, this I know. Come on, are we raised on that? Right? You should sing that to yourself every once in a while. Remind yourself. 1 John chapter 4. Verse 16. Let's take this a step farther. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God and God in him. I'm going to throw this out here just for a moment because we're going to come back to this. It's going to help us. God equals love. Love equals God. God is love. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God. But remember, the word love here is not romantic love. You know, sometimes Christians, they use that as a reason for them to sing secular music. Well, you know, God is love, right? So we can sing love songs, you know, and you don't have to put his name in it. No, it's not. He's not talking about that kind of love. Getting quiet in this church. It's talking about agape love, the God kind of love. We've been talking about unconditional, right? Selfless, everlasting affection. God is love. So notice then, and this will really help us understand the first half of this scripture. John says, we have known and believed the love. It must be a good thing to know and believed the love. Because he's testifying. We have known and believed. We've done good. We have known and believed the love. And notice, God wants his people, he wants everybody, to know the love that he has for them. To know it. Not just to know it up here, but to know it in here. He wants everybody to know in their heart that God loves them. To just be consumed with that. To that be a revelation that drives your life. You live every day knowing God loves me. See, listen, because if God loves the birds enough that he feeds them just because they get up. And I know God loves me. I'm not worried about provision. I know he loved them enough to take care of them. He surely loves me enough to take care of me. I don't have any money problems because I know he loves me. Because he loves me, I will never face lack in my life. It may look like I'm a lack, but by the time God gets done, he's going to turn this thing around because I know he loves me and because I believe in that love. We'll come to that. But notice God wants you to know how much he loves you, to that to be rooted in your heart. Go to Ephesians chapter 3. You know what, better go to Deuteronomy chapter 1. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Let's go to Deuteronomy 1. Let's see why this is so important. Somebody say it again, Jesus loves me. Turn to neighbor and tell him, Jesus loves me. Turn to somebody else and tell him, Jesus loves you too. Yeah, he does. Verse 26, notice what happened to Israel. And this is where you're going to see why it's so important to know that he loves you. One of the reasons right here. This is a time when God, of course, has brought Israel up to the promised land. He's been talking to them about this promised land for a long time. He sent Moses send slaves into, not slaves, excuse me, spies into the promised land. They come back with a bad report. And they're saying that the land is everything God said it is, but there are giants in the land. We'll never be able to take that land. But there are a few of those spies who come back by the name of Joshua and Caleb who say, hey, we can take the land. It's bread for us. God will give us victory. Well, we know the story. We know that the majority of the people did not listen to Joshua and Caleb. They had the pity party of all pity parties. And so notice in verse 26, Moses is talking to them about this. And he said, notwithstanding, you would not go up, but rebelled against the commandment of the Lord your God. And you murmured in your tents and said, because the Lord hated us. He hath brought us forth out of the land of Egypt to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites to destroy us. So because they thought God hated them, they believed God was trying to destroy them. Because he hated us, he brought us out here to kill us. And see, when you have revelation of the fact that God loves you, you won't make this mistake. You'll stop blaming God for the bad things that's happened in your life. You won't have things happen and immediately say, well, you know, God did this to me and God did that to me and God took so-and-so and God needed another piano player in heaven. You won't say stupid stuff like that. You know your God. You won't believe God will make you sick. He won't inject you with sickness to teach you something. You won't believe God will make you poor so you can be humble. You won't believe that God will take your child for some nebulous reason. You'll know my God is a father, and he is not a child abuser. He will never do those things to me. God loves me. The enemy will never trick you again into becoming offended at God and then the word not producing in your life. Because you know your God and you know he is love. And you'll go into your promised land. So God wants you to know this. You know, there's some people in the Bible that knew this and it helped them a lot. Go to John chapter 21. John 21. Jesus loves me, this I know. Say it again, Jesus loves me. You're going to walk out of here today and that's going to be resonating in your mind and hopefully in your heart. And when you face things, the first thing that'll come to mind is Jesus loves me. Because Jesus loves me, I know this is going to be all right. I'm getting ahead of myself. Come on, John 21, verse 20. Notice something that John said. Verse 20 says, then Peter, turning about, seeth the disciple whom Jesus loved following. Wait a minute. John calls himself the disciple whom Jesus loved. If we were to back up to chapter 20 and verse 2, he's talking about when they discovered Jesus was risen from the grave. And it says in verse 2, then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved. What's the matter with John? He don't know his name? No, he realizes that his identity is that of a disciple whom Jesus loved. Come on, go to chapter 13. Some of y'all looking at me like you don't believe me yet. All right, chapter 13, verse 23. It says, now there was leaning on Jesus' bosom one of his disciples whom Jesus loved. Who's John talking about? Himself. John had a revelation. He knew that Jesus loved him. He knew it so much so that he didn't bother writing his own name down. He said, you know what my identity is? I'm the disciple whom Jesus loved. I'm walking around knowing I'm the one Jesus loved. I'm the one. You should step on a plane. Yep, I'm the one Jesus loved. We're not going down. Step on a job. I'm the one Jesus loved. We're about to have some profit in this place. Step in the hospital. You have to go to the hospital. No, but I'm the one Jesus loved. Not only am I getting healed, but I'm a guy. God's going to use me to heal some of these others that he loves. You ought to start walking around calling yourself the one Jesus loves. Look in the mirror and say, I'm the one Jesus loves. He knew it. And you know, the apostles knew it. Jesus said to them later on, he said, love one another as I have loved you. How could he say that? Because they knew he loved them. And that's part of how they were able to be so successful even after he left. They had revelation of this. Well, God wants you to know that you know that he loves you. It not just be something you see in church for a second, but that you have, and it's a part of your heart for life. I'm the one Jesus loves. Go to Ephesians chapter 3. Now, you know, Tiffany has some privileges with me that nobody else has, because she's the one that I love. Right? You all understand that. There's money that she spends. It was funny the other day, I had my little paycheck and she gave me, so I said, hey, did you get any cash out paycheck? We had to run somewhere. She said, yeah, and she reached out and she gave me, you know, like $60, you know. And my daughter Alexa's like, hey, you're giving him money. And I'm like, yeah, it's my money. I made the money. It's like, how come you don't ever have any money in your pocket, Daddy? Asked Angie. Because your mama got all the money. It's all in her wallet. I don't carry a whole lot of money. Your mama has. Well, you know, there's only one person that has that testimony because she's the one that I love. Right? I walked down the aisle and said, hey, I do. I do. And that's just a lower level of love in a sense. You're the one he loves. Come on, if he spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him freely give us all things? That goes back to, what is rent? You're asking God for rent. That's nothing to God. You're asking God to take care of your car. No, that's nothing to God. You're asking God to get you out of a little bit of debt. That's nothing to God. He gave you Jesus. Since he gave you Jesus and he loves you that much, all things are yours. You're the one he loves. Come on, God wants you to know this. Come on, Ephesians 3. Notice how far God wants you to go under, going and learning about this love. Here's a prayer here. We'll start at verse 13 just for a moment. He says, wherefore I desire that you faint not at my tribulations for you, which is for your glory. So notice that Paul's going through some tough times. He doesn't want them to faint because of it. What does he mean? To fall away from God. Because Paul's going through all this stuff, and you know, they start getting mad at God and they walk away. That's his concern, which is why he prays this prayer. If you don't pay attention to that, you'll take stuff in this prayer and you'll take it out of context. For this cause, see that? I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named, that he will grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might by his Spirit in the inner man. So I don't want you to faint. I don't want you to be weak. So I'm praying that God gives you strength. Makes sense, right? That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. Now, he's not talking about them just having Christ in their hearts for the first time. He already mentioned in chapter 1 they are saints, which means Jesus already lives on the inside of them. Okay? But he's talking about Christ continuing to dwell in their heart. Because if they faint, he wouldn't be. It's not that Jesus would leave them, but they could leave him. So I'm praying you'll be strengthened so that you'll hang around and Christ will still be in your hearts. All right, now let me get to where I'm going. That you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ. So God's saying here that I want you to be able to comprehend and know some things. The word comprehend means to seize, it means to take, it means to possess. The word know there means to be aware of, and if you look at some translations, you'll find that it talks about becoming more acquainted with these things. I actually want to read this to you from the Amplified Bible, because I think it does a little bit better job with it. It says in verse 18, that you may have the power and strength to apprehend and grasp with all the saints, God's devoted people, the experience of that love, what is the breadth and length and height and depth of it, that you may really come to know practically through experience for yourselves. Now, other translations, if you study this out, it just simply is talking about you getting to a place where you know more and more and more about the love of God, where you have greater and greater and greater revelation. The Bible says it this way in 1 Timothy 2:4. It talks about coming unto the knowledge of the truth. And that applies to everything. So in other words, as a Christian, I first get saved. I get a first understanding. Jesus loves me. God sent his son to die for me. And I receive Jesus. But then I get some more understanding of it. And then over time, as I keep getting in the Word of God, I get more understanding of it. And as I keep getting in the Word of God, I get more understanding of it. My entire lives should be an experience of us gaining more and more revelation of how much Jesus loves us. That's his point. And notice how much he loves us, and that is, he mentions the length, the depth, the breadth, the height of his love. Okay, so my wife and I, we went to the Grand Canyon. This had to be over 10 years ago, and we got a chance to see it in person. And of course, it's grand, right? I mean, it's huge, and yet, that's the kind of picture of how much love God has for you. That it has length and width and height and depth. That it takes God's help to understand it. You keep reading here, it says, to know the love of Christ, which passive knowledge, which means your mind can't even grasp it. You can't get it up here. God's got to help you to get it in here. And when my wife and I went to the Grand Canyon, we did see some people who apparently, maybe, I don't guess you could pay for it, they were actually, seemed like, on a tour through the canyon. So you could see people walking down and walking around through the canyon. And can you imagine what it would take, how much time it would take to cover every inch of the canyon? It seems like it would take a while, but that's what God wants you to do with his love. You've got this great, big, vast canyon of love God has for you. And God wants you to walk through every single step of it, get every single revelation, every single angle of it, get know it all, so you just get to a place where you have grasped it. You have possessed revelation of how vast his love is for you. Now why? We've already looked at one reason why, but let's go a different direction. Go back to 1 John chapter 4. Somebody says, Jesus loves me. I'm really going to give you three reasons why God wants you to know this love. And today what I'm doing is helping you to know it, but you're going to have to do some work on your own to know it and to keep knowing it. You got to start confessing these type of things every day. Wake up in the morning and say, Jesus loves me. Look in the mirror and say, I'm the disciple who Jesus loved. You're going to have to open up the scripture, the word of God, to the scriptures we're looking at and think about that. Meditate on it. You're going to have to listen to messages along these lines so that you can build up revelation in this arena and you can keep it. And a lot of times we'll go grab a message about God making you rich. We'll go grab a message about being, you're a single Christian, so just how you get married and things like that. But I'm here to tell you, if you get a hold of this message, all the other stuff would just be byproducts. I mean, it'd be so much easier to get a hold of it. But you got to, because God wants you to know that you know that Jesus loves you. If you're in the middle of a car accident, you can see a wreck is coming your way. You can cry out, Jesus. You're not just saying Jesus, you're saying Jesus loves me. And you know God, because he loves me, something's about to change here. So God wants you to know. Now here's some of the benefits of knowing. 1 John chapter 4, verse 16. It says, and we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. I just want you to notice that knowing and believing go together. Revelation is the mother of faith. If faith is the football, then revelation is the air in the football. You've got to know it before you can believe it. And remember, belief isn't just of the head. The belief that makes a difference is that which is of the heart. So when I know it and I believe it is when things can change. So God wants you to know it so I can believe it. In fact, go to Romans chapter 8. God wants you to develop faith in his love. In fact, New Living Translation of the scripture we just read says it this way. We know how much God loves us, and we put our trust in his love. God wants you to get to the place where you can put your trust in his love. You lean on his love. If his love doesn't catch me, I fall. Because think about it. If God is love, then faith in God is faith in love. It's faith in his love. So if the Bible, when it says that have faith in God, when Jesus says have faith in God, he's also saying have faith in his love. When we walk by faith and not by sight, we're walking by faith in his love. And not by sight. We're believing Jesus loves me so much that this will be taken care of. Jesus loves me so much that this way will be made. The just shall live by faith in his love. Because anywhere you see God, you can put love. Because the Bible said faith, God is love. So faith in his love is where God's trying to get to. Because he can only do something in your life if you believe. He can love you all he wants, but until you believe, he can't have access to your life. He can't do anything about what's going on in your life. But if you know that he loves you and you have faith in that love, now God can come in and make things right. Look at Romans chapter 8. That's where God wants you to get to. Come on, don't miss this. Verse 35 says this. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? The word separate here means to make room between. So what's gonna stop God from loving us? Stay with this. Shall tribulation, today we would call that trouble, or distress, that means calamity. In other words, bad things have happened. Persecution, that's when people speak against you or they fight against you because of your faith. Famine or nakedness, that's financial lack. Peril is danger. Sword is war. If you're on the battlefield somewhere, will these things separate you from the love of God? Paul says in verse 37, nay, in all these things. All what things? Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Now, don't miss this. He started by saying, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? He mentions all these different circumstances, and his answer is, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. In other words, when I am in the midst of trouble, Jesus still loved me. And that's why I will be more than a conqueror. When I'm dealing with calamity, he didn't leave me. He didn't abandon me. He was right beside me. And that's why I will overcome calamity. When I'm out of money, he didn't just walk away. He might have been carrying me through this time. But because he loved me, I know that I'm more than a conqueror over financial problems. I could be on the battlefield and the enemy shooting all around. But because he loves me, I know he's standing with me. And the anointing that was on Samson and the anointing that was on David will come on me and make me more than a conqueror, because he loved me. Nothing can separate me from the love of God. God will love you forever. And Paul knows this. He believes this, which is why he's making a declaration of faith. He's speaking his faith. I know the love and I believe the love. So I know that no matter what happens, nothing will separate me from the love of God. God will always love me. I know no matter what happens, because he loves me, he will always give me victory. He'll heal me because he loves me. He'll get me out of debt because he loves me. He'll get me that job because he loves me. He'll bring me that mate because he loves me. He'll help me save my loved one because he loves me and he loves them. Because of his love, I know he'll make things right. See, that's faith in his love in action. Also, I'm not doubting and I'm not afraid and all. I don't know about this situation. I may not know about the situation, but I know about my Father's love. So I don't have to be afraid. Look how he ends this. For I am persuaded that neither, and that's what we need to be, persuaded. That's faith, firmly persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things to come, nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate me from the love of God. And because of that, no matter what comes my way, I know I win. See, faith doesn't just work by you walking in love. Faith also works by you trusting in his love. You hear what I just said? It works by you trusting in his love. Faith works by you knowing God loves you. And so God's saying, I want you to know that I love you. Get revelation of this so that you can be persuaded. So that no matter what comes your way, you're confident that God is going to give me victory. Go back to Ephesians chapter 3. We're asking ourselves, why is it so important to know that he loves us? Somebody say, God loves me.
God loves me.
Ooh, go to Mark chapter 4. Thank you, Holy Ghost, again. Come on, I don't know what you're dealing with right now, but I'm here to tell you, if you'll just have faith in his love, he'll deliver you. I mean, you should put it in your mouth. God will deliver me because he loves me. God loves me too much to leave me where I am. You got to put it in your mouth. You ought to just believe that, confess that. Let that sink in your ears, the Bible says. All of a sudden, things look different. Mark chapter 4. Let me just hit this. Verse 35, and the same day when the even was come, he said unto them, let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship, and there was also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. If you study into this a little bit, you get the impression a demon spirit was behind this. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and said unto him, Master, carest not that we perish? Don't you care? They didn't even say, Master, save us. They said, don't you care? You see, there's a problem here. He arose, rebuked the wind, said unto the sea, peace be still. The wind ceased. There was a great calm. And he said unto them, why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Notice they said, don't you care? And he said, where is your faith? Faith in what? That he cares. Because they had no faith in his love, they were sinking and they were afraid. They were in danger and they were afraid. But Jesus had already said, let us go to the other side. And if they had had just enough confidence in him and in his love, that he would not put them in the boat and have them go out to sea to sink. But if he said it, that he would make sure that they would get to the other side no matter what happened. They would never have said, don't you care. Now, they may have went to him and said, hey, Pastor, hey Master, can you speak to this? Or, but they said, don't you care, because they didn't have faith in his love, they were in trouble. Flip it on his head. When you're sitting in the middle of your storm. And let's take it a step farther, because we're talking about living your story. And a lot of times when it comes to living your story, God's going to require that you step out in faith. Sometimes he'll tell you to leave a job. Sometimes he'll tell you to you know, stop dating some dude. Don't you know all the statistics? Well, God does too, but all you need is one. You know, whatever it is, and there are times where God will tell you to walk in love with somebody on the job, and yet because you don't deal with this situation the way you think it should be dealt with, it seems to get worse. Yet if you have faith in his love, you will realize that God didn't tell you to step out to hurt you. God didn't tell you to walk in love to hurt you. God didn't tell you to leave that guy behind to hurt you. You know he loves you, so everything he's telling you to do, he's telling you because ultimately it's going to help you. And also it helps you to just go ahead and do what God said a little bit more. It helps you to keep on walking in the middle of a storm. It helps you to keep doing what God wants you to do so you can get the results he wants you to get. But you don't get faith like that just because you came to church once. You get that kind of faith where I know no matter what happens, God's going to work it out because he loves me. Because you've taken the time to know. You've gotten the words that you know that you know God loves me. Go to Ephesians chapter 3 again. You know, kids are like that. They sometimes they may not understand everything you tell them to do, but you know, if you're a good parent, kids will look at you and go, okay, you know, I don't get it, but I know you love me. And you'll say, you know, hey, look, I love you. Just trust me. And they'll go along with it because they know you love them. So they have confidence that, okay, whatever you're saying, it's going to be, I may not see it now, but at some point I'm going to see it, and it's going to be worthwhile. And that's really what we need. God wants us to be with him. Here's another reason why. Y'all still with me? Yeah. Turn to them and tell them, Jesus loves me. Turn to somebody else, tell them, Jesus loves me. I should have told you to turn around and serenade them. Some of you would have appreciated and some of you would have said, don't ever do that again. And my wife's up here. I don't think, you know, she should be singing to anybody. No. Come on. Look at Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. Let's see another reason why. The first reason was simply when you know how much Jesus loves you, it helps you to walk by faith. That's bottom line. Helps you to walk by faith. Here's the second reason. We already know he wants us to know, to comprehend the breadth, length, depth, and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge. Why? That you might be filled with all the fullness of love. Now take a moment and meditate on this. I know we're doing all right time-wise. So don't let your mind wander away. Get this. This is deep. God says, I want you to know how much I love you so that you could be filled with all the fullness of me. There clearly is a difference between verse 17 when he talks about Christ being dwelling in your heart and verse 19 when he talks about Christ filling your heart. You can be a Christian and Christ be in you, but unless you get this revelation, you won't be filled with all the fullness of God. And this isn't just talking about being filled with the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. That's clearly a part of things, but it's more than that here. The Amplified Bible says it in this way. It says, that may you have the richest measure of the divine presence and become a body wholly flooded, filled and flooded with God himself. Wholly flooded and filled with God. So in the Bible, we have a story in Mark chapter 5 of a man who was possessed by a demon spirit. I mean, he's basically filled up and being run by this demon spirit, right? Some of you remember the story. It was a legion of demon spirits. The Bible said that this man, you know, he ran around naked. He lived among the tombs. They'd hear him cutting. He would cut himself with stones. They'd hear him wailing at night. When they tried to, you know, to capture him, they put fetters on him, which is much stronger than handcuffs. He had supernatural strength, demonic strength. He'd break it off. His existence was, he was miserable, horrible. Being possessed by a demon spirit is about as bad as it gets in this earth. And yet, that's what this man's situation was. Okay, we had a story in the news not too long ago, a couple months ago now, about a man who attacked another man and ate all parts of his face. It was national news. It was clearly a demon spirit situation. He read the story. It was so bad, they shot the guy. He looked at the guy and kept on eating. They had to keep shooting him. Demon spirit. That's horrible when you're possessed like that. It just destroys your life. And when a person is possessed by a demon spirit, they didn't sign up for that. It's not voluntary. Now, you did some things to put yourself in position for a demon spirit to take over. But, you didn't ask for that. And yet, when you're possessed by a demon spirit, what you'll find is that you're miserable, and yet you have this demonic power to bring fear in the lives of others in some cases. Flip it on his head. Everything that Satan does is just a perverted version of what God created. You know, fear is nothing but faith perverted. Okay? What about when someone's possessed by God? Now, that's voluntary. You know, you sign up. Right? I surrender all. I give myself away. Take over, Lord. We have all these songs we sing. And when you're possessed by God, your experience is wonderful. Just as miserable as that guy is who's possessed by a demon, you flip it on his head, that's how wonderful it feels to be possessed by God. For God to be filled up with him, for him to be able to use you and speak through you and walk through you. And you have a supernatural power too, but it's not to break the chains that they put on you to bring fear into somebody. It's to break the chains in other people's lives by the anointing of God, by laying hands on the sick and casting out devils and raising the dead, because you're possessed by God. Come on, if you were to go to scripture, there's only one man you can find who really was fully filled with all the fullness of God. His name was Jesus. And Jesus walked around possessed by God. And he, of course, you saw it in his life that he volunteered for that. You saw that he was never sick. He was never poor. He was never defeated. Satan couldn't touch him until it was time for him to do what God said. And boy, did he walk in the anointing. Boy, did he set people free. And, you know, if you look at Peter and some of the other ones, you see them walking this a little later. That's why Peter could walk through the streets, and he's so full of God that he's not even ministering to people. He's just walking by people, and God is flooding out of him into the bodies of sick people, and they're being healed just because he walked past them. See, that's not in the Bible just so you can say, oh, that's good for Peter. Peter understood that Jesus had enough anointing on him that somebody just grabbed the hem of his garment. They didn't even touch Jesus. They touched his clothes and they got healed. Peter learned how to get to that same level so he could walk around and people could get close to him and be healed. I'm here to tell you that God has given us the key to doing the same thing, to being like Peter's and Jesus's, walking around possessed by God, prospering and being used by God to set people free. But what gets you to that place? That you would know the length, the depth, the breadth, the height. You would be intimately aware of the love of God. And see, when you really know God loves you, you can trust him with your entire life. And that's how you can say, God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do it. Wherever you want me to go, I'll go. I give myself away, Lord. I surrender all. Take over, Lord. You can do that because you know how much he loves you. And now it's not so hard for you to leave what you have in your life now and step into what God has for you in the future. Even if it looks tough, even if you don't understand everything, yet because you know he loves you, you can do what he said and walk by faith. That's how I can leave a full scholarship at Michigan and go to a Bible school in Oklahoma, because I knew God would not have me do something that would wreck my life, that what God would have me do would set up my life. The same thing is true for you. Some people have not stepped out and done what God said because you don't know how much he loves you. I'm here to tell you, God loves you too much to hurt you and to hurt your family. He's not trying to hurt you. He's trying to save you and save your world. Step out and obey God. When you know how much he loves you, you can be possessed by God. You can surrender all. That's what you got to do. Last one, 1 John chapter 4. Somebody said, Jesus loves me. That's right. Jesus loves me, this I know. Right? For the Bible tells me so. You got to start singing that to yourself. Walk around the house. Teach your kids that. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He loves me. He'll never have me do something that'll hurt me. He loves me. Here's a third benefit of this. It's so simple. Verse 19. We love him because he first loved us. We love him because he first loved us. Notice that really, from this point, most of the New Testament, when it talks about love, it's talking about our response to his love. It started because he first loved us. When I know how much he loves me, that's going to cause me to want to love him back. How much did he love you? Well, we were to read verse 9. It talks about God showed us his love, that he sent his only son into the world that we could live through him. We know what happened when he came into the world. We know that the day came when, although he could have called a legion of angels to stop it, the Bible says that people, they spit on him. They buffeted him. They mocked him. Then they sent him away to be scourged, where he's tied to a wooden post, and they take a whip with a cat of nine tails, they call it, which means that the way it's built, the way it's made, is that when you get hit, it takes the flesh out of your back. And he takes 39 stripes, history tells us, and he just takes it because he loves you. Then the soldiers grab him. They're having a good time. They take him into a hall. They put a purple robe on him. They're going to mock him. Then they put a crown of thorns on his head. How does that feel? bring it down on his head. Now he's bleeding from this as well as his back. Then they take a reed and hit him with it. Then once they're done with their fun, they take this cross. They make him carry until they bring somebody else on to carry it. He still does it because he loves you. Then they nail him to a cross. True nails through his hands, through his feet. Drop the cross into a hole in the ground, which most likely made every bone in his body get dislocated. And then he hangs there in torture for 6 hours because he loves you. And that's not the end of the story, because then finally he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why? Because God, for the first time in his existence, the Father has turned his back on him. Why? Because Jesus became our sin. He took on our sin. He never did anything wrong, but he took our sin because he loved us enough. He wanted us to live. Then when he left this body, he was dragged down into hell. And the Bible says in Acts 2, he suffered the pangs of death. I mean, if what we just finished talking about what people did to him. What do you think the devil did to him? But he went in our place. Went there 3 days, you know, going through that because of how much he loves you. Now, he also went in faith. See, he could say to God, I do always those things that please you. He always did what God said because he knew God loved him. And he knew God loved others. Everything God was doing was going to be a blessing ultimately to him and to others. And he's the only one, though, that had to pay the price he paid for it. So he goes down into hell and he said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. I trust you. David prophesied about it. I know you won't leave my soul in hell. So even though he's dying or he's suffering, all that stuff, he knew because of the Father's love. He always talked about God loved him. That's why he was able to live the way he lived, possessed in obedience. He knew because of God's love, God wouldn't leave him down there. And after 3 days, I think that Satan heard a rushing mighty wind. We'll find out when we get to heaven, but boom, here comes the power of God and energizes Jesus. And he destroys the enemy, takes from him the power of death, rises from the dead. But he knew he had to go through death so you could live. And he did it because he loves you. When you get a hold of just how much he loves you, it's very easy to love him with all your heart and all your soul and all your might, and to say, God, my life belongs to you. Amen. That's the will of God. So I want to encourage you today to get a hold of this revelation. Obviously, this message helps. But do what it takes to know and believe the love. Because when you do, you're going to find that you will be able to fully live the story God has written for your life. Amen. Come on, lift your hands toward heaven. Let's give God praise and glory.